So here's what has happened. One of the victims of Epstein alleged a forced threesome that included attorney Dershowitz. Newly unsealed court documents made public reveal that a survivor of Jeffrey Epstein, sex trafficking, testified that she was forced to have a threesome with Alan Dershowitz and another unnamed woman. The woman, Sarah Ransome, was then compelled by lawyers for Epstein's accomplice, convicted sex trafficker, Ms. Maxwell, remember her, to answer a series of invasive questions about the body and the genitals of Mr. Dershowitz. I want to remind everybody that allegations like this have surfaced previously about Dershowitz. However, he was still allowed to be a commentator. He could break down legal and political issues on national news, not an issue. But these allegations were out there. Now, at one point, he did respond to say he was not a part of any of these shenanigans. But once again, more information comes out that he was. Now, remember, Jeffrey Epstein, he was, you know, he died under mysterious circumstances, according to the federal government. They say he committed suicide. I don't know about that. Now, let's get into the rabbit hole here. Let me give you background on what led to the encounter. In a 2017 deposition, Ransome testified that she had been recruited by Epstein when she moved to New York City in 2006, when she was in her early 20s, and was frequently made to perform sexual acts for him. Within a few months, she said Epstein introduced her to Dershowitz to represent her as her lawyer for a matter involving a man she had met through the website sugardaddy.com. Shortly after this first meeting, Ransome testified that she had had sex with Dershowitz in Epstein's New York residence. Around that time, Ransome said she arrived at Epstein's townhouse one day and found Epstein, Dershowitz, and an unnamed woman waiting for her. Ransome recalled that the woman took her upstairs and they began undressing each other as Epstein watched and masturbated. The two women were later joined in bed by Dershowitz. Here's how Ransome described the encounter, and I quote, "A few minutes later, Dershowitz walked in the room. He started undressing. He got on the bed with the other woman and myself, and we basically had a three-way sexual interaction," Ransome said, detailing that it wasn't a pleasant experience. "I just tried to just get it done as soon as possible to get out of there," she explained. Ransome characterized the encounter as a coerced event and a traumatic experience. She also recounted being extremely upset by the encounter and trying to pay particular attention to the woman because I didn't want Alan touching me. I didn't willingly go, "Hey Alan, let's have some fun," because no one on the planet would say that to Alan. Dershowitz also denies the claims in Ransome's 2017 deposition. "She has no idea," he says, "what my genitals look like. She made it all up," he told the Daily Beast. He also told the publication that he's had sex with one woman since the day I met my wife and denied ever being in contact with Ransome. In addition to Ransome and Guffrey's allegations, Dershowitz was also admitted to visiting Epstein's private island, Little St. James. At one point, he continues to face questions about records showing he also appeared to have a massage on one of Epstein's private planes. All right, here we go. Now, without getting into all of the crazy background to Epstein and why in the hell was he so damn connected while the government was aware that he was trafficking underage children. As a matter of fact, they had him, charged him, and then let it go. He continued, according to multiple allegations, to be a predator, but not just him. Some of the most powerful people in politics and in corporate relations were involved. Now, how do we know that? Well, we don't know all of the players, but we do know this. The federal judge that actually sealed the original document, the original case, said there are people here involved who are the most influential in politics, obviously government and private corporations. Well, that judge did die a little bit after that, but the judge was up in age, so nobody questioned it. Epstein dies in a federal prison while being on suicide watch. He commits suicide, according to them. They just left him for a period of time and came back and he was no more. Why was this even sealed in the beginning? Why so much secrecy, and the person at the center of the investigation is no longer in this physical realm? This doesn't make sense. This doesn't make sense. There's so much more to this. I'm sure we have only experienced the tip of the iceberg here. My dear brother, I'm interested in your thoughts on this whole saga, and I think this saga is going to continue.
I agree 100%. And you know, as far as the Dershowitz stuff is concerned, obviously, you know, I can't make any presumption of whether or not he did or didn't do this, but I will say he has faced so much criticism and, as he says, rejection and blacklisting over this. And to that I say, good. You know, everybody's entitled to legal representation. It's in the Constitution. You could have been Epstein's lawyer and then said, okay, good, I did your case, bye forever. I'm never gonna have contact with you. Dershowitz made the decision knowing about Epstein's behavior, knowing what he had done, because he served as his attorney. He made the choice to be his friend. He made the choice to go on the island, to go on the jet, to get a massage that he swears he kept his underwear on for the whole time. That's your choice. So you don't get to whine about the consequences that come from you making those decisions to hang around someone that you had all the information. There's no way Dershowitz didn't know that Epstein did all of this. And when you continue to be around that person, again, this is allegations aside, just your association with him should be the end of your career. But no, he's become a darling on the right wing. I mean, he's still going on these conservative shows offering his legal analysis, because nobody in the real world of law and politics wants to touch the guy anymore. I was at a legal conference, I think it was about 2006, maybe 2005. And it was a big deal because the luncheon speaker was Alan Dershowitz. Everybody was captivated. You know, this was, oh my God, this is the Alan Dershowitz is here. Those days, those glory days for him, are so far in the rearview mirror that they basically don't even exist anymore.
Yeah.
And he did this to himself. Again, we'll find out with these allegations as everything moves forward. If anything even happens for it, I know the statute of limitations, depending on where all of this took place, you know, that's very unfortunate. But he can't escape his association, and that was a choice he made himself.
You make such a compelling point that I have to highlight it again. You're right. One connection was a professional connection between a client and an attorney. Typically, we can understand everyone has the right to a defense. And obviously, if you have money, you have the right to the defense you can afford. After that, after all of this evidence is on record, after you are well aware of what kind of man Epstein is, you then voluntarily engage in a friendship, not a private friendship. It was pretty public. People were aware of this friendship. You made a decision to become friends with an individual like that. That's a character question for sure, if nothing else. So I agree with you 100%, brother.